for the mind of the magnificent show.
And welcome, my friends, to yet another episode of the Mind Dog TV podcast. I'm Matt Napo. Thanks for coming. It's great to have you here, as always. Caught me just a little bit late. I was actually doing some reading on Twitter, and I forgot how close the beginning of the show was. So bad for me. Very bad for me. We're going to talk to an interesting filmmaker who's got a documentary out on Americans with disabilities in competitive sports. So it should be a very interesting conversation. Before we get started with that, I think you know what's coming. If you've been watching the program at all over the last 100 years, you know about this product. This is not an endorsement, advertisement, or a promotion in any way. It's a test that I am undergoing for somebody who was on the program many weeks ago, too many to keep count. Chris Burris from SES Research was here promoting this product. It's called My Vital C, and it also comes in this form. I do it twice a day, and here's the thing. Chris made some extraordinary claims about this product, and it says so right in the advertising and on the packaging as well, that you can increase your longevity, your lifespan, by 90% or more, which is a hefty claim. It also makes claims about improving the quality of life, giving you more energy, better sleep, better cognition, clarity of thought. And all of those things can be subjective, I guess. But I told him, as a skeptic, and I am a skeptic, not a cynic, that I found some of those claims hard to believe, especially the long life one. And since we don't have any 150-year-old people walking around to prove it, it's especially hard for me to just believe and take it face value. Anyway, so I told him I'm a skeptic. He said, I'll tell you what, I'll send you the product to try it for 6 to 8 weeks. Have me back and we'll review your results on air. So that's what I'm doing. And the reason I'm taking it on air is twofold. Number one, to make sure I remember to do it, because I feel like if I don't do it on the show, I could forget, and that would really ruin the experiment completely. And the other part of it is to have some video evidence to say I in fact did do it as prescribed for the period of time that we suggested. He will be back on October 29th, which is this Thursday at 1 p.m. and we'll review my results then. Now, I can tell you that I have had some good results. A little bit of a spoiler alert here. I have had some increased energy over it. No telling whether that's the placebo effect or not. Not completely successful with it. You know, I've had some days where I did not feel any extra energy, but for the most part, I have. But I take it, and the one negative I will say about it is, and you probably know this if you've followed the program at all, it tastes awful. It tastes awful. So I have to take it with a bit of a chaser tonight. That chaser happens to be iced tea. So here goes. And it's just that simple. I tell you, it is getting a little easier to take after all this time. But we'll see what Chris has to say about my results, and we'll talk to him on Thursday at 1 p.m. Tune into then. And then we'll see if I'm going to continue to do it. I'm not going to continue to do it on air. I can tell you that much. My sponsors tonight, we got a new sponsor I want to tell you about, and it's MyBookie.com. MyBookie.com is one of the most popular and trusted brands in the online gambling community. Its sportsbook offers an incredible variety of sports, from American staples such as football and basketball to international sports such as KBO, rugby, and cricket. I don't know what KBO is. If anybody wants to clue me in the chat room, I would be happy to learn about whatever KBO actually is. It even offers wagers on entertainment and politics and simulated sports such as video games such as Madden 21 and NBA 2K21. If you're looking for a line on your favorite TV show, you can most certainly find it at MyBookie. You can bet on TV shows and plots and things. Who would have thought? MyBookie's casino options are as plentiful as its sports books. There are 27 different table games such as blackjack and roulette, and almost 300 unique slot options, 77 of which are 3D. Yay, 3D. I don't know if you have to wear those kind of virtual reality headsets with that. That would be kind of weird. You can even play live game table games and video poker, which I would be up for if I were so inclined. Mybookie.com, use the promo code MindDog. Go to mybookie.com and use the promo code MindDog, and you get your match your first $100 of betting. Good offer. I would take it up if you're into gambling. The links, of course, will be in the description. My guest tonight, as I mentioned, is a filmmaker. Excuse me, got a little congested here. Is a filmmaker with a documentary out. Now let's take a look at the trailer before I bring him in. Let's.
And together, our Olympians and Paralympians brought home more than 200 medals from London.
And that was really a purpose of this initiative. Why go to California?
To include and increase the opportunities for students with intellectual and physical disabilities.
Now, being disabled myself, it's like, no, you're not going to get away with that with me. And
do I want to train for hours and hours for a 20-second race?
It'll take a bit of time. It will. We are a huge state.
I usually don't get to see that when I'm running against my regular high school teammates.
She's going to have to put in a lot of work to make the next world team.
Look, two bags, a surfboard, and a bicycle. That's the way you want to go to college right there.
So she was on probation when she competed at state.
They like had me lay on a table, did a bunch of like stretches with my arm. They looked at it.
But she's really blossomed already in the long jump.
So there's two things going on. One is they got rid of that event, his classification for Tokyo, and two, everybody needs to be classified.
The fact that they're competing at a high level is by far the most important thing right now.
Yeah, I hope I didn't break it. I hope it's just a sprain. I don't know what I'm gonna do if it's broken.
Now, you see there, it said coming soon. It's been out for a while, and you can find the actual documentary. We'll have the link to that. You can find it online. The link will be in the description, of course. Aligning with the 30th anniversary of the Americans with Disabilities Act, the ADA, filmmaker Scott Marshootz created the film Let Him Play to bring light to just how accessibility legislation impacts individuals, families, and entire communities. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my pleasure to introduce you. Please open your ears and open your mind and help me welcome in Scott Marshutz to the Mind Dog TV podcast. Scott, welcome.
Hey, how you doing? Thanks for having me.
It's my pleasure to have you. So the film looks really, we saw the trailer there, looks like a high quality production. Not your first film, but by any means, right?
Well, actually, you know, that's not the trailer that we've been, that's on the website. I don't know. That must've been an old one you pulled from YouTube, but that's okay. It's fine.
Yeah.
But to tell you, that's my first big project, that, you know. So, and we had some big news just last week. We just got a distributor. So that's going to, you know, help us launch quite a bit in the spring of 21.
What was your inspiration? Why did you want to take on this subject per se?
Well, it goes back 4 years. I was a freelance writer, freelance journalist for a long time. And, you know, I got pitched a lot on a lot of, you know, projects and stuff. And this one pitch I got invited me to an event called the Angel City Games, which is being held at UCLA. And I'd never heard of it, but the pitch was really good. And I thought, you know, maybe I should go out and take a look. And went out there and was really blown away. Jaw just dropped open when I saw all these disabled people competing in sort of Paralympic style sports. And, you know, I knew how the Paralympic Games work, but I started talking with, you know, some coaches and athletes and parents about what was going on. And one thing led to another, and I found out that California had just adopted rules for high school disabled athletes. And so it kind of took off from there. You know, it's a very underserved community, especially out in California. And so I thought instead of just writing a one-off piece, magazine article, I tried to develop into a film, and, you know, away we went.
It must have been. So did you fund this thing your whole self, all by yourself? Because it seems like a pretty big undertaking there for production wise for a guy who's working a journalism gig to just drop all the kind of funds it would take to do a quality distributable film.
Yeah, well, you know, I pitched it to my crew and the guys that were working for me, and they all really sort of locked into the story. And they were, you know, I took them out to these events and they saw these disabled athletes, you know, competing at this really high level, and they were literally blown away. And so we were able to negotiate the rates down because they really believed it and they wanted to be a part of it.
Right. So tell me about the making of the film. I'm sure you probably experienced some challenges in the filmmaking and the time it took to make the film and all the kind of stuff that had to go into making the film. What are some challenges that you had faced that you wouldn't face in a normal filmmaking type of, you know, any kind of regular documentary where you're not dealing with, you know, the politics of being at schools? First of all, it's got to be challenged. I'm not even sure what the challenges are. Enlighten me. What were your special challenges? Well, making
the first thing we had to do was, you know, we cast a wide net as to which athletes, you know, might work in the film. And they were all under 18, so we had to get buy-in from their parents. We had to get releases from the parents. Yeah. That was a little bit of an obstacle, you know, because they were a little kind of leery of us and who are these guys and what do they want to do and all that stuff. So that had to be a, you know, a pretty good pitch there from us. And then we had to narrow the field down. I mean, you know, you have to kind of pick your spots and, you know, logistics was a big thing. You know, we couldn't just kind of pack up everything and jump on a plane every 15 minutes and go do this. So we had to be within striking distance so we could kind of drive to, you know, see whether they were competing and things like that. So the other thing was that we wanted to, you know, a variety of disabilities and good backstories too. You know, I think all four of them have really good backstories, and I think the viewers can really kind of, you know, kind of support one or the other or all of them all at the same time. So there were a lot of things going on. You know, we had a really good crew and really, you know, we're a small crew. I mean, I don't think there was more than five of us at one time.
Wow.
And so we were able to, you know, pivot pretty quickly and get out to these events and go for it.
Right. Were you just focused on California or did you take it past the borders of the state?
Right. Well, we shot a lot of it in California, but a lot of it was in Arizona, too, because the main when these kids advanced out of the California system, they had to get what they call classified. So, you know, depending on their disability, they had to go in front of a panel and the panel had to give them a classification, which is really a license to compete internationally. And so once they did that, you know, we tracked them into this very high competition, you know, para-athletic world, if you will. And they were going up against, you know, some of the top, you know, athletes, you know, from around the world.
That's so cool. I have been supportive of the Special Olympics here. And I know that when I was making some comments supporting the Special Olympics here in New York, where I am, of some parents who had children with special needs. I don't know if they just misread what I, but I got attacked quite a bit. That mistrust factor, like, what's your agenda in this kind of thing? So when you said, first of all, the parents didn't trust you, or there was that lack of really knowing what to expect at first, I can relate to that because I've experienced that firsthand myself. Why is that, do you think?
Well, first of all, just to backtrack a little bit, the Special Olympics are completely different from what we're talking about here. It's a completely different system, a completely different philosophy. Our angle was to show basically how these athletes coming out of California, you know, from the first inaugural event into the Paralympic competition could make, or hypothetically could make, the U.S. Paralympic track and field team, which is completely different.
Yeah, okay, yeah, that's like the real deal. And they're taking it out of Special Olympics and competing with people who don't have those challenges, right? Is that what you're saying?
So every 4 years you have your able-bodied Olympic Games, and then right after that you have your Paralympic Games.
Right.
And that's a completely different ballgame from Special Olympics, a completely different organization.
Gotcha.
Completely different. So a lot of people lump them together and they think they're one of the same, but they're not.
I just did.
Special Olympics have been around for 50 odd years. They've got a very well-funded organization, but they're more on the intellectual side. And it's less about competition and more about trying to, encourage those athletes to be part of something and growth.
Right. And that was the point I was making. Participation is more important than winning when I was talking about that stuff. And that's kind of the stuff that got me a little bit attacked on social media for even saying that. So what you do is really, really focused on winning in the competition, right? Am I correct?
Highly competitive. I mean, these athletes are going for the gold. They're representing their country, and they want to win gold, or at least, you know, gold, silver, or bronze.
Wow. And,
so, you know, our kids, you know, coming out of, you know, California and getting involved in this high stakes Paralympic, competition was a long shot. I mean, you know, it takes 10 years for these athletes to really, really get good. Just like it would be an able-bodied, in a major league sport. You take, you know, football, baseball, basketball, you know, you come out of high school or college, there's got some growth years there before you get really good. And it's the same way with the disabled side.
Yeah.
Or the para-athletic side.
I get it. Yeah. Same amount of time commitment and patience and all that stuff goes into it. Now, you're using the term able-bodied. Is that the politically correct term I should be using from now on?
Well, yeah. I mean, it's kind of runs through it, you know. I mean, you talk disabled versus able-bodied.
Right. Yeah. I fumble because you don't want to say normal person because that denigrates the people who have special challenges. So I don't know, but thank you for that. So I'll just refer to people, athletes, as able-bodied until somebody corrects me on that at some point, I guess. So was it a challenge coming down to the ones that you chose to feature? Because I say that because even though you might find some really great athletes, great stories to feature, they might not be so good in film. Because I know that I've had some great opportunities to have guests that I thought would make really interesting stories, and then not so good in television or radio. So was that a challenge for you to find these people that not only had a great backstory and all of that, but also could present it well within a film context to make it presentable to the general public?
Well, to tell you the truth, I mean, it was kind of roll of the dice. It was kind of a crapshoot. You know, I can't say, you know, on the air that it was all well planned out and, you know, we picked the right people, the right spots, the right time. And it was just like we kind of went for it. We were hoping for the best. And we got really lucky in terms of, the para-athletes that we did pick. And, everybody was very transparent. You know, the parents, you know, really liked this idea. They got involved. You know, the California Interscholastic Federation, which is the governing body of all sports in California, they were very transparent. All the coaches, the advocates, they wanted, because there hasn't been a lot done like this. There hasn't been very many independent films that really focused on the U.S. There's one out right now that just came out, but it's all internationally focused. So you see it all happening sort of around the world, but you don't see the focus in what's happening in the U.S. And that's what we wanted to do, because it's so underserved.
Right.
And so with California finally adopting these rules, now more collegiate programs are being, you know, being launched. San Diego State University was the first one in California to really, you know, launch what they call an adaptive sports program within the college and those kinds of things. So, you know, more events are being created now, and there's kind of more of a spotlight on it. And we were hoping to do more of that as well.
Right. Is there a fear that, and not fear, but a concern that it might be exploited, like, because anything in sports, they want to find a way to capitalize it and make money on it, put it on TV, whatever, get people to pay for it. And is there a concern among the parents, at least, that, and is that where it comes from, that where the distrust thing that I kind of mentioned a little bit, where they're fearing that, I don't want my kid to become like just fodder, no matter what he's doing. I don't want him to become fodder for somebody else's money making scheme and taking advantage of exploiting the kids, because maybe we can get people to tune in saying, well, they have physical challenges, and make it about more about that than about the competition. Is that in play at all?
You know, right now it doesn't appear to be, but it's a really good point. It's almost like, you know, a good follow-up angle. Yeah. But we're not seeing that right now because of this, you know, COVID shut down everything. Right. I mean, our film was being edited when we got shut down. and so the whole thing just went from 100 miles an hour to zero.
Right. It's that way with every film in every genre across the board. I spent 4 years putting together a film, hoping to get it into festivals. And then there were no festivals to get it into. So I just kind of stopped production and post-production on it at that point. So I feel your pain there. So what's your outlook now, though? Are you getting any doors starting to open up in that regard?
Yeah, you know, you know, I think everybody's hoping for, you know, the 2021 season. Everybody's, you know, looking forward to that. All the athletes are really jonesing to get out there and compete. You know, they spend their whole lives, you know, trying to make this team, you know, U.S. Paralympic team. And it doesn't matter whether it's the track and field team or the hockey team or the, you know, the wheelchair basketball team. I mean, they're so really focused on getting out there and competing because that's what they want to do. And, you know, you can only train so much for so long before, you know, you got out and see what you're made out of. So, they're all looking forward to that. And we're all hoping that, you know, they can have a season and compete at Tokyo in 2021.
With the idea of it being so competitive, though, and I don't want to try to create controversy, I'm just asking out of curiosity. In able-bodied sports, we see competitiveness causing athletes, even in the high school and below, even little league and that kind of stuff, to try to cut corners, whether it's stimulants or any cut corners any way they can. Are we seeing that happen? That would be a real shame, but I can't imagine. The more competitive it gets, the more tempting that has to be. Am I correct?
Yeah, you know, absolutely. You know, the IPC, the International Paralympic Committee, which is a governing body of this whole system, you know, they have testing in place, and it's, you know, it's regimented and it's enforced. And you can only hope that the system is just, you know, covering all their bases, and it's a, you know, a level playing field.
Yeah.
And that's another reason why they had the classifications the way they do. I mean, you know, when, you know, depending on your disability, you know, you're not going to be running against somebody that has a different disability than you. I mean, they try to make it like for like. So when you're, you know, competing in the 100, 200, whatever the event is, that you're going to be running with other people that are have the same disability.
Right.
So, you know, that infrastructure is strongly in place.
And most, I'm guessing, and I'm a total novice at this, so if I sound like an idiot, it's because I am one. But I'm guessing that most of these people competing have had the disabilities they have since birth or something. So I'm wondering, when does it occur to them that I might have a gift and I might be a talented athlete? Do you see it happening like in early grade school years? I mean, where did they get the impetus to say, I could be an athlete someday?
But, you know, it's a really good point that you're making. And it's something that we were trying to really sort of examine in the film. Depending on the state where you live, you could have, like, I know in New Jersey and some of the Eastern Seaboard states, they have programs for these disabled athletes to get involved pretty early, you know, and they have more, they have clubs and they have, you know, I believe they have rules adopted in the high school system already. You know, if these disabled kids, these para-athletics or para-athletes, I should say, if they want to play, if they have the motivation to play, they can find that, that system pretty quickly, I think. But in the states that don't have it, it's a lot tougher.
Right. I can imagine. Yeah.
You know, I mean, California is just now getting on the board. And you think about all the, you know, athletes that we have in the state and, you know, the amount of sunshine and training and everything else that you think would be a slam dunk, but it's not. You know, it's taken off. I think California became the 25th state to adopt rules for disabled high school athletes. Okay. So that means there's still a lot more. I mean, since the film's been completed, I think some other states have come on board. We just haven't had time to track all that. But you can see where it's happening and where it is. The states that already have the infrastructure in place, have those athletes can get in real quick and find out right away whether they can compete or not, you know, if they want. Right.
And I think, and, you know, again, I'm going to be completely apologizing for myself for this whole interview, but I would think and not know that, because I've known some parents with children with special needs, and they tend to have a limiting belief themselves about what their children can and can't do. And if you suggest they try something, you don't know, because they deal with trying to take care of somebody with special needs, they kind of assume that you don't know what they're incapable of as well as I know what they're incapable of. For me to suggest, well, why don't you get them involved in music or something, like, you don't know what you're talking about, you know, and thanks for your helpful suggestions, but they can never do that. So that limiting belief about what the parents have can affect whether a child would even take that first step. And I think that could probably be an issue with some kid who might be, you know, might have potential that a parent doesn't realize. Did you find that to be true at all?
You know, it really depends. What we found is that there are three big areas here to, you know, if a kid has any kind of motivation to play sports, regardless of their disability. One is, do they have the parent support? You know, do they have some resources? Do they have any advocates that are going to help them, you know, and encourage them? And is the system in place already in their area? As to, you know, I mean, one of the athletes in our film, you know, her dad was a coach, you know, a running cross country coach. So, you know, he was always encouraging his daughter, Michelle, you know, to, you know, get involved, you know, and this will make you feel better. And you'll, you know, you'll be involved and you'll be able to see what your potential is.
Right.
You know, and that's really what happened. And where you have other parents that really don't have kind of a sports background or an interest in sports, it might be a little bit different, you know? But if, and sometimes, you know, there was a couple of kids in the film, two out of the four actually, that they brought the idea to the parents and said,
right,
I really want to do this. I think I can do this. And they're saying, okay, let's figure it out. You know?
Well, that's great. That's great that their parents said that. That my concern was that I know a lot of parents who would try to talk them out of it. You're only going to break your heart, and you know, because the parents develop those limiting beliefs, not the kids. Kids mostly believe in themselves more than the parents do, and I think that's the issue I was kind of trying to get across there in a very awkward kind of way. So at some point, and this is the fact of life in everything, politics will get involved. And so when we talk, California is a fairly liberal state, so I would assume they would be on the cutting edge of this. But when you talk about legislation for inclusion and allowing these opportunities for these kids, funding for special equipment and stuff like that, money's got to become involved, and then it becomes a political issue. Did you see any of that kind of, you know, who's going to pay for this stuff and where we're going to get the money from it now becoming a political issue?
Well, you know, it's always going to be there. Okay.
Right.
You know what I mean? There's no way to avoid it, but
right.
You know, in the first couple of years after the adoption, you know, for the high schools in California, I mean, the state put up, you know, several million dollars, you know, and there was like three entities that came together to make this happen. And Special Olympics were involved, and the U.S. Paralympic and excuse me, U.S. Olympic and Paralympic Committee were involved. And there was one other I can't think of, but they were able to lobby the state of California to get these funds in place to provide that. You know, the necessary equipment and support for these kids. And it's only grown. It's grown to, now don't quote me on this, but I think it's somewhere over $2 million per year. Now,
right.
That doesn't sound like a lot of money for, you know, a state that has, you know, I don't have the actual number of high schools on the top of my head.
Right. I would imagine that the budget for able-bodied people sports would probably be somewhere in more neighborhood of like $200 million. So $2 million does not seem like a lot of money.
Right, but it's a start, you know,
right.
And we jumped in right at the start of this and we wanted to be able to show that, you know, at least they're trying to do something here to make, you know, sports available to disabled athletes, you know,
right.
High school kids that want to play, you know,
right.
Is it the best scenario? Probably not, but at least they're working toward a, you know, bringing something online. You know?
Right. As far as the sports themselves, because the equipment costs, of course, are dependent on what the actual sports are and how they're played. So wheelchair basketball, for example, they're not necessarily like the regular off the shelf wheelchairs, right? I would imagine that kind of special equipment for wheelchair basketball. It's not just a standardized wheelchair that you would get as you were leaving the hospital, right? From your bypass operation or whatever you got. Am I correct in that?
Absolutely. No, they're very expensive. They're, you know, $4,000 or $5,000 and up.
Right.
You know, but you know, there's a lot of organizations out here. Challenge Athletes Foundation, for one, you know, gives grants to kids that are looking for equipment like this, especially if they show, you know, potential and, you know, excelling in that particular sport. And there's other organizations as well. USATF Southern California has gotten involved. You know, so it's not like it's just the state, you know, providing this money. They're private organizations that are, you know, are helping out and have helped out for quite a long time.
Right. What about the sports themselves, though? Because I'm thinking, you know, who makes up the sports? Because it's you know, baseball, if I look at baseball, we don't know who invented baseball, but baseball evolved over the 19th century. By the time it got to the 20th century, we kind of had it figured out, gave credit to Abner Doubleday or whoever invented it, Andrew Cartwright, But these sports actually had to be invented by somebody. Are they still evolving? Do they still change? Who actually determines what are the best sports to create for people who are have physical challenges?
Yeah, no, that's a great question. Let me backtrack a little bit. The whole idea here was that after the 2012 London Paralympic Games, the U.S. Olympic and Paralympic Committee wanted to increase their numbers. They wanted to get more athletes involved. So they looked at states, Ohio, Texas, and California, large states with well-established high school sports infrastructure already in place. And they went to those governing bodies and said, hey, you know, if you guys want to implement a system, it's very easy to do. So what California did is we'll say, okay, we'll do it, but we'll do it in track and field and swimming to begin with. We'll take those as kind of a beta test and we'll see what happens. So that's when they adopted those rules. It was for a limited number of events in track and field and swimming. And that was it. So they'll probably grow into more sports as the project grows. But right now it's limited just to that.
Well, I'm when you're saying that, I don't know why, but my mind went back to Jim Abbott, who used to play for the Yankees, and I forget who else he played for, but he was a one-arm pitcher who made it to the major leagues. And so I'm thinking there's no reason that there can't be some adaptation to the sports that people already love beyond track and field and swimming and that kind of stuff that can't be adapted for people with special physical challenges, right? Am I right in
that? Yeah, you know, you'd think there'd be more of that already in the majors, but for whatever reason, there isn't.
Right.
You know, just far and few between. You know, I don't know what the answer to that is. You know, I think that as more of a spotlight gets shown on these Paralympic Games, I mean, you look at NBC, I mean, they're, you know, when they broadcast the able-bodied Olympics and then they, like a week later, they do the Paralympics, those events that they're broadcasting are a lot more than they used to be. I think they broadcast something like 50 hours or more of the Rio Games in 2016. So there is more interest, and you'd think that that would kind of bleed into some of the other sports too.
Right.
You know?
Yeah. I don't know how to say this without sounding insensitive in some way, but I'm going to go right because I don't really have much of a filter in my life or in my mind. Often, we will see motivational speakers or inspirational guys who will give up, using people as an example, athletes with specific challenges to say, you know what, these people are doing it. What's your excuse? You have an able body. What's your excuse? These people are going after their dreams. They're achieving anything that they set out goals for themselves to achieve, and they don't let, you know, other people's conceptions or misconceptions stop them from achieving their dreams. And motivational speeches will often include, well, look at this example, they're doing this, what's your excuse? So with that in mind, when I watched that trailer and the girl said, I don't know what I'm going to do if it's broke. And I thought, well, that we're coming right back to the, like almost feeling like self-defeated. And so these people go through the same kind of mind games that able-bodied athletes go through, number one. But that also that why isn't she a little tougher than that? Considering all she's come through and overcome at that point, are you going to let a thing like a broken ankle stop you or whatever she was, I don't know, foot, whatever she was saying, I hope it's not broke. Is there any of that, or am I being like overthinking this kind of stuff? Because I would have thought that, you know, that any, you could, once you've developed that mindset of I can overcome a physical challenge, you can overcome anything, right? These people are super people. They're exceptional people.
Absolutely. I mean, they're what motivated us. If they can go out on the field and train for as many hours as they train, we can get out of bed and go film this without any complaints at all.
You know? You go. That's what I mean. So we see a lot of people in life just thinking, I can't. And when you look at people like this, you say, well, I'm really foolish and weak forever doubting my own abilities or using anything as an excuse, right?
Right. I mean, it's a great motivator.
Yeah.
It really is. You know, you look at all the tools that we have to succeed in life, and you know, we just have to hurdle those obstacles, you know, and you know, you surround yourself with scenarios that allow you to do that, you know.
Do these, and I'm imagining that you got to know the athletes well enough to kind of get some personal insights into how their mind works and what their real motivations and goals are in life beyond the competition and all that stuff. So when we see able-bodied athletes doing this, they have an eye on a prize that goes long beyond their competitive days, in many cases, endorsements or whatever they're thinking. Do these people have, do they share any of those thoughts with you?
Absolutely. I'll take one, for example, Michael Sayle, who's a wheelchair basketball player. You know, his goal was really to play wheelchair basketball in Europe after he's done with his undergraduate degree from University of Arizona, where he plays on the team right now. But this is almost a verbatim quote in one of the last scenes where he says, you know, I don't care how much the paycheck is. If I can go over Europe and play basketball, I'm a happy camper. You know, that's what I want to do. I mean, he was like totally locked in and totally focused on it. He said, you know, as long as the check gets me by and pays my bills, that's all I care about.
Wow. And that would be a major accomplishment for him, and it'd be an inspiration for the entire world. Now, I, when you're saying that, I'm just thinking there is no reason that somebody who was possibly wheelchair bound couldn't make a good NBA coach. Do you agree with that?
Well, you know, I mean, you know, I'll take Michael as an example again. He was really focused, you know. Everybody thought he was going to become a lawyer, you know, but he's, you know, majoring in computer science. When I interviewed him, when we interviewed him probably four or five times through the course of 4 years, it was amazing to see his growth and how well he was seeing his future. And you could tell he might be a coach, you know, because of how well grounded and how well sort of how he'd already figured out so many things, and he hadn't even turned 19 yet, you know.
Right. Do we see, because it's hard, I'm not, again, I'm really removed from this stuff and don't know much about it, but do you see a lot of these people going on to live you know, fulfilling lives career-wise? I'm not sure what the percentage of, you know, I don't know. And again, I apologize if I'm being insensitive here because I don't know the proper disabled, physically challenged, whatever they are. People with these challenges, sometimes they just tend to give up on careers and just think I'm going to be a ward of the state or stuff. Do we see a higher percentage of athletes becoming independent, self, you know, proficient and saying self-determined to say, I'm going to develop a career for myself and not be a ward of the state, as far as within the challenged community. Again, struggling to be politically correct here, which is not my forte, but do we see a higher percentage of athletes among this population, becoming more independent and self reliant?
Absolutely. I think that, you know, the fact that they were motivated to get into sports and competitive Paralympic sports the way they did, they don't want to sit around. Okay. Right. They want to be, productive citizens, if you will, and not have to be, a child of the state or whatever you want to call it. They want to be out making their own living and making their own money and being independent and, you know, having a family or whatever. So I think that, you know, it's funny when we would go out and shoot practice sessions or being at competitions or whatever, you know, you would watch the coach and the athlete together. And the coaches really never treated the athlete as disabled. you know, wasn't about their disability. It's about why couldn't you make that, you know, couldn't you cut that 2 seconds or you do this, or what's wrong? You know, we got to get going here, you know? So it was more about that than, oh, poor so-and-so with your disability. It wasn't like that at all.
Right.
Hey, you got to get out there because, you know, we got a race to run. You know?
A coach always has to be a hard ass, no matter what your situation is. That's a coach's job, is to be a hard ass. And right. I appreciate that. So my mind goes back to there's no crying in baseball when I think of that. How did this, making this film, did it change your life? Did it change you as a person?
Well, I'll tell you, the day that I went out, that, you know, I got pitched on that event that I was telling you about earlier in the program. And when I got out to Drake Stadium, which is on the UCLA campus, and I saw all those athletes, all those para athletes playing and having the time of their life, I mean, it just, you know, warms your heart.
Right.
Say, oh my God, this is like incredible, because it wasn't just kids. It was from 6 to 60. I mean, you know, they were all involved, you know, and to see the joy of the parents, you know, to see their kid finally getting involved in something, it's hard not to change you. I mean, you go, wow, this is like.
Absolutely. So on that note, though, we talked about how just being who they are makes them more self-determined, self-motivated to become self-reliant. And I think that's a good thing for society in general. I can't imagine why this isn't more of a win-win type of issue for local politicians to get behind. Do you have, and I, you know, I don't want to get political here, but whether it's right or left, it doesn't matter to me. But it just seems like a good thing for society to get behind, and therefore, I would think more politicians would want to use that for their own political gain. Are you being recruited in any way as part of any of that kind of impetus?
not really. You know, I see your point. It's easy for people to, I think, get on board. Not difficult to realize that, you know, these kids and these athletes want to do something with their lives, and let's support them. And how do we get the support to them? And, you know, what kind of infrastructure do we create and all that? It's not rocket science. It's pretty much, wow. You know, let's help them out as much as we can. And that's why, you know, the Angel City Games, for instance, is doing a lot of that, you know, and there's other programs being launched that are helping in that degree too. But, you know, in terms of the local politics, you know, I can't really cite an example of one that's sort of taken place since my films come out or some of the other films have come out. But once I think our distributor, you know, gets our let them play onto some platforms, you know, this spring, I think that'll probably help it.
Right. Well, it, you know, exploitation can be a two-way street, and I would think, and not, you know, it's not always a negative thing. So in order, we talked about getting funding for this thing, in order to get some of the funding for that, it might be good to exploit the politicians' own self agenda, or, you know, their own agenda for advancing their own career, to say, you know what, you should get behind this. This is a people oriented issue. You can help us get funding and help your own career. And so I know you're not involved in that level. You're the filmmaker and documentarian, but I would think that the people who are organizing the sports might be looking at that and saying, you know what, we need funding. We need more than $2 million. The way to do it is to make these politicians feel like there's something in it for them to get behind the cause.
Well, I'm sure that, you know, California Scholastic Federation is probably doing that. You know, I haven't been talking to them lately since we completed the film, but I'm sure that they, you know, they're lobbying the state, you know, constantly more money because of how big it is.
Right.
We have, you know, you figure there's what, 1.9 million you know, kids enrolled in a high school, California high schools, and 10% of them have disabilities. That was one of the graphics that came up in the trailer. You know, that's 180,000 roughly that have some sort of documented disability.
Wow.
So, you know, that's a lot of kids that have potential to play sports in this system, you know?
Right, right. And it is such a, you know, I don't want to sound like a broken record, but it is such a good thing for society to see this and not only see it, but be part of it. It alleviates the burden on society to take care of people who can probably overcome challenges and end up taking care of themselves in one thing. But it also encourages the able-bodied among us who are, for one reason or another, you know, abdicating our responsibilities to take care of our own selves and becoming dependent on society to take care of us. It's just a great thing in my view. So I can't imagine why. And it's one of those things that truly can be bipartisan. It doesn't matter if you're Republican or Democrat. You should really, really support this because it is so good for society. And that's just my soapbox moment on this. Now, the film has been out, right? It has been out, or it hasn't been out online. Can you watch the full film online?
Right. So I see you've got the URL, you know, up on the screen right now. You know, yeah, they can watch it from there. And we've got a donation wall up there, so if they could just throw in a buck, that would be great, you know.
Oh, you're not charging for it at all? It's all voluntarily, so I can that. Oh, wow. Well, that's a good thing, but I would think you should charge for it. I mean, people should be able to cough up what they paid for a regular movie.
It's a custom thing. They can put in 50 cents. They can put in a buck. Whatever, you know, and they get a receipt and a nice little thank you note from me and they can watch the film. But, you know, since we got picked up by the distributor, that's really going to, you know, put us on an upper level, you know, bigger tier. And, right. You know, the timing might be good because, you know, if all systems are go and, you know, the Paralympic Games, you know, are played, you know, in August of 2021 in Tokyo, you know, our content will be probably, you know, played on several outlets, you know, right around that time.
Wow.
That can only help promote the whole concept and the whole idea.
Sure. So when you're talking distribution, are you thinking theaters, or are you thinking like Netflix, Amazon Prime, what, you know, streaming modalities like that?
What the distributor does, you know, we just inked this deal on Monday. You know, they're a Canadian distributor, and they know their business, and we're just happy that, you know, they wanted the film, and they thought they could make some money from it, you know.
Yeah, it absolutely does look like a compelling film, without a doubt, and something that I would think would be of interest to a lot of people. And so I'm surprised that it's by voluntary donation only, but good for you. I mean, that's I'm happy to see that you are not so much all about the buck as most people are. But you know, I have a conflict in my mind about some of letting people just have well-crafted art and for free and making them volunteer to pay. It just do most people actually, you know, cough up something or do you see it like
we did a soft premiere in July when it first came out and we let it out for free for a certain amount of time. And we got a lot of views, and we got, and those were really more for the people that were involved in the film and the athletes, the para athletes that are shown in the film. And we kind of spread it out on social media a little bit. But we're going to do a lot more of that, you know, now that we're kind of, you know, on the next tier. And, so we haven't been doing a lot lately, but we're going to kind of gear up, you know, and do quite a bit, get a lot more aggressive on the marketing side. And so, you know, again, I mean, there's another film out there called Rising Phoenix, which really tells the international story about the Paralympic Games and how it all got started. But ours is the only one, as far as I know, that really concentrates on the U.S. and on a particular portion of the U.S.
Right. So what, this wasn't your first film, was it?
Well, it was my first big project.
Do you have plans for more feature length films in the future or not?
You know, I grew up in New York and I'm a big sports guy. And my father was a commercial director. And so, you know, I grew up watching like NFL films and stuff like that. So,
NFL films, are they? They're still, you know, an entity, right? They're not part of the NFL, but it was a privately owned company who did the work, was contracted for the NFL for all those years. Is that still the monopoly that does that?
You know, I'm not sure what their organizational structure is.
I
know that they did a lot of work for the NFL, obviously, and that was their big, you know, connection, if you will.
Right.
But from an artistic standpoint, I was always looking at how they produced those films.
Right.
Making a very violent sport and turning it into like, you know, ballet and opera almost, you know, and I thought that was sort of cool. That kind of thing. So.
And the great voiceover work that always got you was, I don't know, that guy was out of Philadelphia, the announcer who did that stuff. But he just, he captivated you. You look more forward to that Friday night release of that NFL Films highlight reel every week as much as you did to the game. So, but that stylistically, what, any other big topics that really pique your interest beyond this?
Yeah, you know, I was influenced early by, you know, like D.A. Pennebaker and Bruce Brown and, you know, the guys that were doing the music and sports like the Woodstocks and the Monterey Pop Festivals and, you know, that those kind of all the Rolling Stones concert films and stuff like that. I really locked onto those. So I kind of sort of molded a little bit of all of it into my vision. My parents were really into film, so we were always going to watch movies, you know. So it was kind of in my bloodstream, you know.
Well, I wish you a lot of luck. I thank you for coming tonight. And again, for the people who are just listening and don't see the screen, which is probably the majority, the URL for the documentary is letthemplaydocumentary.com. And then you can see the real trailer there, I guess, and watch the real film online and make a nice donation and make sure you tell them you heard about it here. So we want to make sure that we know we are helping. That's all that's about, that our people are actually finding the stuff and taking advantage of it. So I wish you a great success with this film, and I hope it achieves whatever you're looking to achieve with it. And by all means, you make another film or you want to come back and talk, you're welcome to come back. It's been an eye-opening conversation. There's probably a lot more I left on the table about things I'd love to know about these sports and these athletes, and I hope it continues to evolve and becomes more of a mainstream thing. I do think it's good for society, and I think what you're doing is it's a benefit and adds value to people's lives, and you're leaving a powerful legacy. So thank you.
Well, I appreciate it. Thanks so much, and thanks for having me on, and best of luck to you.
Yeah, same here. And again, if you have another film you want to kind of
Oops, we're done. I guess we're done. Did we lose it? Oopsie. Lost it. Hello? Hello?
You know why you can't hear me? Because my mic was muted.
Oh.
No, I had some kind of quick power outage there. So we were just saying goodnight and thank you. And anytime, come on back when your next film is out, if you want to promote it. I'd be happy to have you back.
Appreciate it again. Thank you. Have a great night.
Bye. Oh, I've lost my output here on my speakers here. How about that? Is that a little better? Well, Scott Marshutz, folks. I hope you appreciated that. I hope you got something out of it. I hope you check his film out. Again, it's at letthemplaydocumentary.com. fascinating subject. I think it's good for society. It's good for all of us. So please check it out. And again, mention that you came from the Mind Dog program. So we know that we're reaching people that are actually doing something and helping out. I hope you enjoy this program. I hope you come back and tell your friends about it. Go to my YouTube channel, subscribe, go to minddogtv.com, get on my mailing list, and questions and comments for me, info@minddogtv.com. That's info@minddogtv.com. I'll be back with you in an hour from now with the fabulous Joey Gaynor for a special kind of late night here on the East Coast, anyway, late night episode of the Mind Dog TV podcast. We're going to be talking about the history of comedy at the Comedy Store, in particular with the fabulous Joey Gaynor. Showtime has a special series out on the history of the Comedy Store right now. And they left some of the stuff out. And Joey is a guy who's been in the trenches, a former protege of both Andy Kaufman and Richard Pryor, which is a deadly combination, if you ask me, or an incredible combination of comedic power between the two. Joey's been around a long time, and he's had a very storied life in comedy. So he'll have a lot to share with us. I look forward to seeing you then. That's at 10 p.m. Eastern, 1 hour from now, right here on the Mind Dog TV podcast. Till then, I'm Matt Knappel for the Mind Dog TV podcast. Thanks for coming, and bye for now.